say, when they first got divorced, every time he'd come down, they'd get into an argument. Or because I was younger, he had to make payments because it was close and bitter, and he had to pay mother $3,000. Of course, it helped mother get on her feet. With that $3,000, she was able to rent a couple places. She'd rent the property, and then she started building those rental properties. And the place on Craig Street, she bought that one. She paid $800 a month. She thought that was terrible when I was young, so she had me keep books for each house. And of course, she paid me $25 an hour. Lived on the third floor. There's a nice little room up there. I went to school on the GI Bill, but that wasn't really enough. 333 Melwood Street. Ran that apartment. Had a street walker in one of the apartments. This one woman, we always knew when she was in business. She was on the first floor, and she had a rug. And whenever that rug was out, she was busy. When the rug was gone, she was not busy.
I heard this story from Mary Jean. Granna had a tenant that she knew had a man in her room, but she could never catch him. One night, she knew he was in the room, so Granna went and tapped on the door. The tenant came to the door and asked, "Who's there?"
"Mrs. Olander."
"Oh, what do you want?"
"I have a letter for you."
"A letter? Are you sure?"
"Yes. Open the door and I'll give it to you."
"Are you sure? It's so late."
"Just open it a crack and I'll slide it into you."
When she unlocked the door, Granna shoved it open, marched past her, over to the bed against the wall, looked down at the man who was lying there and said, "This room is rented for one, not two," and marched back out again.
Mother evicted quite a few. Sometimes it's tough to get somebody out. You know, she didn't want to unless she had to. You have to put their stuff out on the street. Sometimes she had to take their stuff as collateral. Housekeepers were good, you know, brought in the money, and she'd go around and collect it. We had a lot of character tenants. Mrs. McGovney, and she'd sew all the time. She had a Southern accent that you could cut with a knife. Never been to the South, but boy, you'd swear she was straight out of the South. We had a couple. She was a knockout. Her husband was so jealous. He treated her like a queen. You marry a movie star, you have to go around watching every move. you know, you learned a lot about characters. I wasn't interested in working, but I got interested in painting. Ange taught me how to paint. You had to paint a room a day. That was before the rollers. Mr. Ziegler died, and I went up there to paint his room, and I swear I could smell his cigar. Like a ghost. That's why she had a crew, Ange and Ward and Walter, who was deaf. Walter was quite an interesting fellow. He could read your lips and he could talk, and you'd have to really listen carefully to. And I remember he told me he was painting in a church and the ladder cracked and broke. He took a jump and grabbed hold of the balcony and saved himself. You painted with him, you were covered with paint, because he was about the messiest painter, because he'd go so fast. Mother loved that. She loved a good, fast worker. Ange, he was something else. He had been a professional painter, and he had fallen off of a ladder and broke his feet. And then he became sort of the foreman. Every year or two, he'd buy new furniture. He was up to his neck in credit, and Mother kept saying to him, "Why don't you buy your furniture instead of making pay?" You know, Mother was too. And I'll have to tell you about Floyd Bird Bigler. Huge. He would have made a wonderful lineman for the Steelers. Yet when they tore down Clyde Street, Floyd takes this big couch. He just carried it like nothing. And he went down the stairs, plaster flying on either side of the steps as he was coming down, bang, bang. I used to take out the garbage. I had a big sack. Mother paid me $9 a week. Nice pin money. Mother did most of the rent collecting. The landladies would give her the money, and she'd go over the books. add it all up. And that's probably why she wanted me to keep the books. So we all used to kid her when she'd count her money. She'd hit it with her thumb and used to say, "Oh, you love your money so much, you lick it." She said, I said, "Well, isn't renting a hard business?" "No," she says, "you have a paper route." She says, "You go around and you collect all the money from the people at the paper route. I do the same thing with rents. It's easy. It's all just sitting there. You don't have to do anything." Yes, she owned the Henry Street.
There.
We called them the Pepper Pots. But they all had chimneys, old pictures of Pittsburgh. And she owned the two houses that she rented out. And then she bought the apartment building. And she lived there for a good number of years. And her backyard went all the way back. She had two flowers back there, sold the whole thing to Mel. She sold the apartment building to Pitt. She made a lot of money on that. And the nice thing about Forbes Field, they would open the gates in the seventh inning, and anybody who wanted to could walk in and see the rest of the game. Mother, you know, used to rent to ball players on the radio. They would say, "Anybody who would like to rent to some of the Pirates?" And of course, Mother picked up on that all the way. And I met Roberta Clemente. I stopped in the middle of dinner out and showed Roberta Clemente. He couldn't speak very much English. The boy dressed to the hilt. And I said to him, "Well, are you going to win the championship?" His interpreter said, "Yep, soon we're going to win the championship." And sure enough, 1960, they went to the World Series. And Manny Sanguian, the catcher, he lived right over there in one of Mother's apartments on the first floor. And John Henry Johnson, who was a great Steeler, he lived at Clyde Street. Really a nice guy. And at the time, I was tutoring a kid in Pitt. He was like a beginning reader. Big, though. Introduced him to John Henry Johnson and took him up to the Steeler practice field. They gave him a uniform, part of the Steelers, because he was a big kid. I was getting gas. Guy got out and he says, "Mr. Olander, do you remember me?" It was this kid, doing well. I don't know whether he was a member of the mob or not, but he was doing well.